gentlemen, it's my pleasant task this evening to welcome Dr. Adam Perkins. Adam is a lecturer in the neurobiology of personality at the Institute of Psychiatry, Psychology and Neuroscience, Park King's College, London, as I guess you know. Adam did his PhD under my supervision, and I still remember those days and what I'm recovering.
Philip used to have jet black hair.
And Adam's work was on the cognitive neuroscience, I guess we'd say, of fear and anxiety, developing human analogues of animal rodents, batteries. And Adam developed a joystick task to measure fear and anxiety.
With the help of Rob Davis here, who's an engineering genius.
And since then, Adam's applied that to patients at the Institute of Psychiatry, as it was, using fMRI and other techniques. Adam's published widely in Translational Psychiatry, Journal of Personality and Social Psychology, Molecular Psychiatry, Journal of Experimental Psychology, Journal of Neuroscience and Emotion. And in the last publication, Adam identified a new facial expression for anxiety.
Which you're probably seeing right now.
Adam also won this year from the International Society for the Study of Individual Differences, of which I'm president, the Young Researcher Award. But I can tell you the competition was very stiff, so it was great that Adam received that.
I was the oldest young researcher. Adam oldest.
Perhaps because Adam does study personality at the Institute of Psychiatry, as it was, and following in the footsteps of Hans Eysenck, as some of you may know, Adam's extended his scientific concerns to social issues. So tonight Adam will be talking on what some of you may think is a controversial topic, certainly a polemical topic, the relationship between the welfare states and effects on personality, the notion being that some people take advantage of the welfare states, those of a disagreeable, non-conscientious character, and they subsequently pass on by social means, not genetic means, social means, those dispositions to the children, and it's a consequence of the welfare states. So, as you can discern, this is a polemical area. It's not an unimportant area, of course. Questions of science, ethics, morality come into this, let alone politics. But what Adam has done, I think, is to adopt a scientific perspective to an important social problem, which we're going to hear about tonight. So, no further ado, over to Adam.
Thank you, Rob. Slow the lights. Yes, so thanks everyone for coming and braving Hurricane Desmond. It's impressive to see. I was worried that none of you would come, so this is great. So you might have noticed in the newspapers there's a tendency for politicians to flirt with science, citing academic papers or name-checking trendy theorists like Thomas Piketty, let's say. So tonight we're not going to flirt with science, we're going to have a disgusting, filthy one-night stand. there's going to be no data off limits. It'll be so probably some data you're familiar with, but some you're not. And hopefully it will begin the debate on personality in the welfare state, because at the moment, there isn't one. There's only one review on Amazon, but the guy said he couldn't believe this is the first ever academic book on personality and welfare state. So he said, for being that brave, it deserves 5 stars. So he didn't mention the literary qualities, which is probably a good thing. I'm not going to get bogged down in the details, particularly, because as the first theory, most of the details are going to be wrong. That's just how science works. And so I'm following in the footsteps, really, of Tom Schofield, who said, science is not about finding the truth at all, but about finding better ways of being wrong. So if by the end of the lecture you think I'm wrong to claim that there's a connection between personality and the welfare state, well, you're right. I will be wrong. What counts is the degree of wrongness. And I'm pretty, I'm pretty sure that my theory of welfare-induced personality misdevelopment is the least wrong theory, because it's the only one. If somebody gets spurred into action by the inadequacies of my theory, great. You know, if they can show for lots of strongly evidenced reasons why I'm talking nonsense, fine, that's great. It will advance the topic and it will advance our understanding of the topic. I can't be too precious about protecting my little pet theory. Not when there's something as important as the future of the welfare state at stake. I'll try and finish my talk as quickly as possible because you might well have comments you want to make. And don't pull your punches, because each hole that you can punch in my theory is progress. That's how it works. I must thank Philip for chairing this event. There's few people that know more about personality than Philip in the world, full stop. So it's a great honour to have Philip here. And also I must thank King's College London for hosting this. There's actually a lot of Christmas parties going on, hence the number of venues are not available, not great, hence we're in this rather large place. But I hope you can still engage with the topic despite the vast area of space. I must thank Palgrave Macmillan for publishing the book, particularly Paul Stevens for actually spotting the potential of this as a Palgrave Macmillan book, and my awesome editor Nicola Jones, who is not only tough-minded but also very conscientious. She sacrificed last Christmas holiday to read the draft manuscript, and then she was still working on the final manuscript up until the day before she gave birth on the 1st of July. So thank you, Nicola, and congratulations on becoming a mom. Palgrave Macmillan did offer to pay for a drinks reception, but because there aren't any rooms available, we can't have one, but you probably want to come to the pub afterwards, because you'll probably need a stiff drink. That's when you finish my lecture. I know I will, because personality research is a kind of unique area, I think, in that it probes the attributes that form the core of our being. So it is challenging. It kind of challenges even those of us who work in the area. And when I speak to people who have other careers, I tend to get quite polarized responses, either very keen or horrified. Let's just have a show of hands. Raise your hand if you're quite keen on personality research. Okay, that's good. Now, raise your hand if you're horrified by it, or, you know, uncomfortable at least. Anyone? Go on, put it up for a moment. Well, okay, hopefully by the end of today, I'll persuade you the reality is somewhere in between. So, personality research isn't magic. But it's not useless either. When this book was being sent out for peer review, one of the academics who refused to peer review the book, he did so on the basis that there's no such thing as personality. It's just a capitalist construct. So that's not only ill-informed, but also ironic, because the first guy to study personality and show there was a biological basis was Pavlov, who of course worked in the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics. And he not only identified a biological basis for personality, he also named his dogs after their personalities. So on the left we see, this is actually called postrel, which is colloquial Russian for gunshot, because this dog had a lively, bold personality. The other one is called Zhurka, if that's right, pronunciation. It's colloquial Russian for moaner and grumbler. And this dog had a timid, cowardly personality. And the key thing is, Pavlov noticed that the personality of the dog affected how easy they were to condition. So the more bold the dog, the harder they were to condition in their learning experiments. It still exists at his research institute. This is in St. Petersburg in 2012. He was very fond of his dogs, so he built a memorial to them. Clement where the dog, this is actually the chamber where the conditioning experiments were done, the famous metronome and food ones. And actually you can see the attention to detail that Pavlov had, because the testing chamber is free hanging. It's not only soundproof, it's also suspended within another room to cut down on vibrations. So you didn't want that to affect the conditioning experiments. So Pavlov's pioneering work showing the biological basis of personality in dogs has been followed up in humans by, for example, Hans Eisen. His PhD student, Jeffrey Gray, and Jeffrey Gray's PhD student, Philip Moore. So we're great to have Philip here today. So a great example of Philip during his PhD, Philip did an experiment where he showed the paper and pencil measures of sociability actually moderate capping effects on learning. So you can see here the highly extrovert people, they learn better when they're on caffeine than when they're on placebo, whereas the introverted people, they learn better when they're on placebo. So these paper and pencil questionnaire scores are actually moderating a drug effect on learning, which shows that these personality questionnaires are not just some kind of party trick. Yeah? This is the kind of flack you get as a personality researcher, because people just aren't aware of this kind of finding, which Philip brilliantly showed during his PhD. So, nevertheless, just because my book is based on peer-reviewed papers and the book itself is peer-reviewed, it doesn't mean it should be accepted without scrutiny, any more than a drunken statement in the pub. So I'm just going to present a brief summary of the evidence today that the argument is based on, and then I hope you'll present counter-evidence, you know, that shoots holes in my theory, so we can have a sort of open debate. So let's have another show of hands. Raise your hands if you've encountered someone who is difficult to work with. Okay. So by difficult to work with, I don't mean someone who's occasionally grumpy or is going through a rough patch after a divorce or anything like that. I just mean difficult to work with. Then now raise your hands if the reason why they were difficult to work with was particularly because of their personality. Okay, so that's about half now. So we can see that in your own experience, personality does seem to affect how we work. And what you're visualizing when you think of that person who is difficult to work for is someone who's got the employment-resistant personality profile. Okay? So this is a scatter plot. This is just one of my studies that I did. It's 2,532 people. So, in the jargon of personality researchers, these people are low down the dimension of agreeableness and conscientiousness. So they struggle with being reliable and diligent, but they also struggle with cooperating with workmates. Okay? But you've got to bear in mind, these people were volunteers. Yeah? So, that in itself is a demonstration of conscientiousness and agreeableness. So the real full spectrum in the population, you have to imagine this grey arrow kind of extends down here. And way down here you'd have people who are sufficiently unconscientious and disagreeable, they would meet the criteria for things like antisocial personality disorder. But that's a very extreme end of the spectrum. So I'm in this box, by the way, as Philip will tell you. I'm pretty familiar with being undiligent and not that cooperative and stubborn there. So I also have a PhD, and you might ask how that happened. So I'll just briefly give you a biographical detour that will help illustrate what this employment resistant personality profile really means in practice. Even as a child, I noticed that I was less diligent than my peers. They slavishly would follow the commands of the teachers and so on and so forth, burn the midnight oil, and I just used to loaf around, essentially. And not in a party animal, designer label wearing, cool John Travolta kind of way. Nor was I one of those anti-establishment loafers who wore long dark coats and hung around in hip coffee bars, listening to the Smiths and flicking their hair, looking moody. I used to have hair, at least. But at least these loafers developed social skills that would help them get jobs and things. And my loafing was much more solitary and dysfunctional, like making my own crossbow or panning for gold in the local river. It was unsuccessful, obviously, otherwise you'd be looking at an empty stage. But my parents were very hard-nosed, diligent people. They worked hard to create respectable existence. They realized that I wasn't very normal in not doing any work, really. And particularly because my sister was the opposite. She had a very conscientious, very agreeable profile. She worked, got through medical school, became the youngest consultant and oldest in the country, all this kind of stuff. Had two kids along the way. So I think they concluded that one out of two wasn't bad. Anyhow, I got terrible grades at A-level. I was rejected by all universities that I applied to. I'd always liked the natural world. I liked Wales, so I just rang up the admissions tutor at Cardiff for biology, Richard Cowie, and managed to talk him into letting me in. So I eventually did get in to do biology at Cardiff, but I still didn't learn my lesson. I loafed around. Graduated eventually, but where my peers had all been doing summer placements at biotech companies and things like this, I didn't. So I ended up not being employable in a graduate level way. So I just moved up to London and worked for 10 years or so as a labourer, doing data entry. The longest I was anywhere was 2.5 years in a clothing warehouse, quite near here actually, in Wandsworth. And I actually got fired after 6 months, but it was such a grim job that the bosses asked me to come back. Because they couldn't find anyone else to do the job. At the same time as all this was going on, I did retain my thirst for knowledge and read like voraciously across the full spectrum of art and sciences. And while I was reading in Senate House Library, I discovered there were people researching personality from a biological perspective, which dovetailed nicely with what I'd actually done as an undergraduate. So slowly the sort of fog began to lift, and I could see an interest that was kind of relevant to everyday life, but tied into a biological framework. And so one good thing about spending a lot of time in the library is you don't spend much money. So I eventually had enough money to do a PhD or MSc with Philip, and then a PhD. And I was now following my interests, so I found it quite motivating. And I actually got quite a lot of research grants, some prestigious papers. And a couple of years ago, I was appointed lecturer in neurobiology and personality at King's College London. So I'm at last working as a lecturer 10 years after I would have been if I'd listened to the teachers at school. But I couldn't have done it any other way, really. And spending a decade at the bottom of the economic pyramid helped me to sort of tune into real life, which I think perhaps is not quite the case in all the more ivory tower academics who haven't labored away for years in basic jobs. If we come back to the scatter plot, this is just an approximation. So people can have employment difficulties for all sorts of reasons, and we can find people who are highly conscientious but just really uncooperative, or people who are very cooperative but just never turn up to work. But what we know from studies is that these two dimensions, on the whole, people who score low on agreeableness also score low on conscientiousness. They are, in most cases, the same people. So the argument in the book is that that the welfare state is eroding the economic prospects of society by increasing the proportion of individuals in the population who possess this personality profile here. And this is based on two key discoveries. First, we have the finding that employment-resistant personality characteristics are overrepresented amongst welfare claimants. And this is to be expected because people who are relatively unconscientious and disagreeable will tend to get fired, like I did. I'm an expert in getting fired. They will filter onto the welfare rolls at a higher rate. That's perfectly logical. And this difference in personality between the average employed person and the average unemployed person means that cash transfers to that sector may not have the same behavioural outcomes as cash transfers to the average population. Second, we have the discovery that exposure to childhood disadvantage promotes the development of employment-resistant personality characteristics. Okay, so this means a welfare state which increases the number of kids who are born into disadvantaged households risks eroding the work motivation of the nation just by increasing the proportion of individuals who have developed an employment-resistant personality profile, as is shown here, due to exposure to disadvantage in childhood. And a major question I often get is about the channel by which childhood disadvantage damages personality development. You know, what's the actual channel? How does it become ingrained in the mind? So we can address this issue by conceptualizing the employment-resistant personality profile as a tendency to break social norms concerning work and responsibility. And that allows us to utilize existing knowledge concerning process by which norms are instilled in a person. It's known as socialization, and it's been studied for decades. And a leading theory is that an individual's level of socialization is determined by an interaction between the size of their dose of genes for being difficult to socialize and the quality of their upbringing. So this comes from the work of David Licken, whose model of socialization has at its heart the notion that children at both the low and the high end of the genetic spectrum, the difficulty of socialization, are relatively insensitive. So you've got a small number of people at the low end, a small number of people at the high end, and these are genetic hard cases. So he would say, regardless more or less of their environment, they will turn out to be what they are. So the low people will be easily socialized, the high people will be difficult to socialize, regardless of what environment they grow up in. But what he says most importantly is there's 68% of people are in the middle. So we're kind of like, most of us are here somewhere. This is just using conscientiousness data as an example. So we're the sort of easily swayed kids. So if we happen to be landed in a privileged, affluent, nurturing household, we will turn out okay, we'll get a job. If we happen to land in a disadvantaged household, then we're less likely to. We're more likely to end up having problems with socialization. So a common objection to this argument is it's easy to find people with employment-resistant personality profiles who are from the sort of privileged sectors of society, the kind of hooray Henry upper class hooligans that you get at public schools, at the universities like Exeter or Durham. A few of them might be genetic hard cases, possibly, but I think the vast majority of these people are just as much the product of inadequate socialization as employment resistant individuals who are born into disadvantaged households. The channel by which that inadequate socialization occurs is probably different. I would suggest it's being spoiled and indulged, I would imagine, if you had to pick a reason. But the end result is the same. These sort of upper-class brats are just as difficult to work with as somebody whose lack of socialization is through disadvantage. You know, they've had all the privileges in the world, but they're still employment-resistant. But the key difference between them and children whose personalities are damaged by disadvantage is that they're not born in response to incentives from welfare policy, nor are they likely to be dependent on the welfare state because their families tend to sort of fund them with trust funds, cushy jobs, this kind of family support network. And that's not ideal for society, but it isn't really changeable by changing policy. So short of forcing these more affluent parents to sort of be strict with their kids, I'm not sure what governments can do necessarily. But when it comes to helping children from disadvantaged households, there's a lot that governments can do. First, the studies show that intensive preschool tutoring can help to ameliorate the negative life effects of a child's disadvantage. So the most famous of these studies is the Perry Preschool Project, which showed that 2 years of intensive in loco parentis preschool tutoring from the age of 3 to 5 significantly improved the life outcomes of the disadvantaged children decades later. For example, at the age of 40, the children in the Perry Preschool Project who did not receive intensive preschool tutoring earned approximately 25% less, had twice the rate of unemployment, and were twice as likely to be incarcerated as the tutored children. And this is random assignment. So these children are randomly assigned either to receive the tutoring or not. So it's a genuine causal relationship. And initially, the mechanism by which intensive preschool tutoring helped was thought to help reduce the negative effects of childhood disadvantage. It was thought to be by improving IQ. That was what it was initially about. But it turns out it's not correct. There's no significant differences in IQ between the tutored children and the untutored children. Instead, it turns out the effects are mediated by personality. So in 2013, Heckman, Pinto, and Samoyev showed the personality profiles of the tutored children were on average significantly less aggressive, antisocial, and rule-breaking than those of their peers who were not tutored. These facts give us a good argument for government intervention. It suggests that preschool tutoring is worth doing because it can improve the life chances of disadvantaged children. But the trouble is not all children are disadvantaged, so the Perry Preschool Project only gives us a partial picture of the scale of the damage to adult life outcomes that can be done by childhood disadvantage. So to fill this gap, we need to compare the life outcomes of the two groups in the Perry Preschool Project with the life outcomes of less disadvantaged people in a similar demographic profile. So a useful start point is to note that the intensive preschool tutoring only lasted for 2 years, and so the tutored children remain disadvantaged compared to individuals who were born into families which provided adequate care from birth onwards. This insight allows us to conceptualize the untutored children in the Perry Preschool Project as representing a high disadvantaged group, the tutored children, a medium disadvantaged group, and then the population average, a low disadvantaged group. So by comparing life outcomes across the three levels of disadvantage, we can put the effects of both childhood disadvantage and the tutoring into perspective. We can sort of compare them to how are the average kids getting on. And this only provides an estimate of the relative scale effects on childhood disadvantage on life outcomes, because this was published back in 2005, so absolute figures on annual income and employment rates are not particularly meaningful now, 10 years later. Anyhow, what we find is that there's approximately linear dose-dependent effect on life outcomes. So significantly fewer of the tutored children were unemployed at age 40, 24%, compared to the untutored children, 38%. Yet their rate of employment here was still almost 3 times higher than the average rate of unemployment for that group of in the American society. Significantly fewer of the tutored children, 28% had served a prison sentence by the age of 40 compared to the untutored. Well, over 50% had been incarcerated at least once. Yet the rate of incarceration is still more than twice as high as the population average. So they show that childhood disadvantage damages life outcomes in both the employment and criminal domains. But more importantly, they allow us to obtain an estimate of the scale of the burden imposed on society by childhood disadvantage. And this is a conservative estimate, because this average here includes disadvantaged kids. This is just a broad average. So if you stripped out that population, you would get an even lower figure. So the estimate would be just simple. Divide the number for the high childhood disadvantage category by the low childhood disadvantage category. So 38% were unemployed, whereas only 8% for the low disadvantaged group were unemployed. If we divide 38 by 8, we see there was a 4.75 times greater rate of unemployment amongst the untutored disadvantaged kids compared to the average people. Likewise, it was a 4.3 times greater rate of incarceration here compared to here for the criminality. So this could just be an artifact of sampling differences. These life outcomes for the average group are just a broad average. They're not the same as these carefully selected experimental groups here. But this is where you get the kind of sanity check from the kind of median group. So there does seem to be a sort of rough dose effect of high disadvantage, medium disadvantage, low disadvantage. It may not be a fluke, put it that way. And the key thing is that personality contributes about half of this variance. So some of it's just random differences, but about half of the variance is down to the experimentally induced changes in personality between these two groups. These are the tutored kids, these are the untutored kids. We'll skip ahead a bit. Okay, so from these data, which are from randomized controlled trials, you can see there's a bit of a hint that there might be something going on with personality and disadvantage. It can be a driver in societal effects on criminality and on employment. But what does the welfare state have to do with this, you know? Well, as you remember before, I said if you have a welfare state which increases the number of kids born into disadvantage, you would get personality damage as a result of that policy. Those kids are being parachuted into these disadvantaged homes. They're going to get damaged personalities. But that requires the welfare state to be affecting reproduction. So does it? Well, here we see a basic table from UK government statistics on reproduction and employment in England and Wales for April to June 2013. Okay. So they measure reproduction on three levels of reliance on the welfare state. Working households, where every adult's working, mixed households where some adults are on the dole, some are working, workers households where all adults are unemployed. And there seems to be a tendency for the number of children born into disadvantaged households to rise in step with the degree of reliance on the welfare state. It could be boosting reproduction, but this is just raw census-style data, so there's lots of other reasons why you could be getting this pattern. It could be that just the more children you have, the more help you need from the state, something like that. There's lots of confounds going on. So, fortunately, there's been studies which have looked at this in detail and looked at causality. And they show that increased generosity of benefits does increase the number of children born to claimants. So this is the opposite pattern to what we would expect if poverty increased reproduction. So a good example is in the USA. Are there any Americans here? Yeah, so in the USA in 1996, there was a thing called the Personal Responsibility and Work Opportunity Reconciliation Act, signed off by Bill Clinton. And this ended the requirement for states to provide extra benefits to families who had additional children while on welfare. in an attempt to discourage families on welfare from having extra children. It was called the family cap. However, even before this act was signed into law, a number of states had received waivers from the federal government that allowed them to cease providing extra benefits for extra children born to claimants. So this created a natural experiment which was utilised by Argies et al. 2000. And what they did is they used this kind of natural experiment, and they compared the effects on reproduction of states with differing policies on the payment of financial benefits for children born to 1,168 unmarried women who reported receiving income from welfare during at least 1 year between 1979 and 1991. And they were also able to contrast differing levels of generosity between states that did pay extra benefits. They found, for example, that in 1991, a mother in Mississippi would receive $101 on the birth of a second child, whereas a mother in California would receive $178, almost twice as much. What they found was that economic variables influenced the reproductive behavior of the welfare claiming people. The availability of incremental welfare benefits awarded for each additional child produced was positively and significantly associated with reproduction. This finding is congruent with those of other studies in the US that show a similar tendency for the increases in generosity of payments to be associated with the increase in births. Morphitt, 1998, was one. But what they did is they looked at the states where there were reductions, and what they found is that reductions in childbearing in response to reductions in benefit generosity were achieved by the increased use of contraception, because they did follow-up interviews to look at causality. So that would seem to be evidence from the USA, and in a bizarre coincidence, in the UK, in the late 90s, in 1999, the UK government boosted the generosity of per-child benefits by approximately 50% in real terms. So while the USA was going that way, in 99 we were going that way. So it was a different attitude. And there was a 50% hike in real terms in benefit generosity. And what they found was that this was significantly generous to the extent that the birth of the first child in a household in the bottom fifth of the UK income distribution would increase household income by 10%. So these are not tiny changes. And they looked at this in great detail. It's worth a read, this paper. And they found that there was a 15% rise in the number of kids born. So a 50% hike in generosity produced a 15% rise in the number of kids born to these families. And they were able to show that this was nuanced according to the specific circumstances of the individual women. So the benefits that were accomplished by increases in income support for workers' households and the introduction of the working families tax credits were all given to people who were in the workforce, at least one of the people in the household. So there was a bigger increase in births to women in couples than in single mothers, which reflected the effect of the rules for the working family tax credits, which meant that mothers in couples whose partner worked 16 hours or more per week could leave the labour force altogether and yet still have an increase in their unearned income. So Brewer et al. Found that the increase in reproduction was causally linked, because they then did these follow-up interviews and found that these changes in fertility were achieved by reductions in contraception. Quite within the rights of the people, because this is what the rules said. So in the US and the UK, we're getting quite sophisticated peer-reviewed evidence showing there is some link between fertility and benefit generosity, and it seems to track. So when it goes up, it goes up. When it goes down, it goes down. So these studies, you probably already realize there's a paradox here. There's a couple of paradoxes, actually. So raising children generates work in its own right. It might seem plausible, instead of having extra children in order to increase benefits, people with employment-resistant personalities wouldn't want to do it, because they don't want to do the extra work of 18 Second, increases in household income due to greater benefits should reduce disadvantage and therefore reduce the risk of personality misdevelopment. But both these paradoxes can be resolved if you remember that there is evidence, which is in the book, it's from the Dunedin study, which is a longitudinal New Zealand study, which showed that children with relatively unconscientious, disagreeable personalities at the age of 11 or so, not only turn out to have poor employment records when they're grown up, but they also have a higher risk of becoming teenage parents. So that part of the employment-resistant personality could be a lack of foresight. So this suggests employment-resistant claimants may indeed be more likely than people with an average personality to have extra children to maximise income, because their lack of foresight means they'll focus more on the short-term rewards rather than thinking about the long-term extra work that's needed to raise a child. Secondly, their personality generalises across situations. So if an individual's not sufficiently conscientious to work for a living, they're also unlikely to manage their welfare benefits conscientiously to benefit their kids. So increased generosity is unlikely to trickle down to help the children of claimants because the parents, on average, their personality profile is less conscientious and agreeable than the rest of the population. This is why I was referring to cash transfers to a particular subsection of the population may have different effects than to the average population. And this was backed up by this several longitudinal case control studies of families in Sheffield in the 1970s and 80s who were troubled families who were in contact with the social services for problems in their lifestyles. And this showed that relative to a comparison group of matched controls, the problem families not only had a significantly higher level of employment-resistant personality characteristics, and worse work records, but also had more children. The case controls were matched for income. So the troubled families had approximately the same income as the families living nearby who weren't troubled and were used as the case controls. And what they found is in the troubled families that the income wasn't managed to benefit the kids. It was frittered away on purchases of electronic gadgets and things like that, rather than food and heating and clothing. So if we view these data here in the light of these follow-up studies, it starts to look more believable that there might be a link between the number of kids born and the payment of benefits. But these census-style data don't tell us about how important personality is in this. Here we've got a bar chart ascending. How important is personality? Personality might just be making a difference right down here without any real significance in the real world. So what about the effect size compared to other factors? Well, this is where a thing called the Troubled Families Program comes in. Has anyone heard of the Troubled Families Program? It's a government program that was initiated in December 2010 to help the 111,574 families in England who had three or more adjustment problems to turn their lives around. So again, these are families with multiple issues who require a lot of intervention from social services. And the data replicate the results of the Sheffield studies because they show that troubled families not only display higher than average rates of antisocial behaviour, but also higher than average levels of unemployment. Now these associations are unsurprising because they were the admission criteria. You know, you don't get into the Troubled Families Program unless you've got problems with employment and antisocial behaviour. However, the key thing is family size wasn't used as an admission criteria. So family size was nothing to do with whether you got into the Troubled Families Program. So in line with the notion that these employment-resistant personality characteristics make a person more likely to be willing to have extra kids to get more welfare income, we would expect the troubled families on average to contain more children than ordinary workers' families, you see that, this is the average number of trouble households compared to, that's the same data as before. So it's not a watertight comparison, it just shows there seems to be a trend in this direction. So these data are, I think, probably quite an important piece of evidence that there's something going on between employer-resistant personality characteristics and the welfare state. So I therefore argue in the conclusion that the welfare state is in danger of proliferating employment-resistant personality characteristics, because you can see here more kids are being born into these troubled families. And as we know already, getting born into a disadvantaged household puts you at greater risk of developing employment-resistant personality characteristics. So as a postscript to the analysis, there's just been a new paper come out, Haller, Lackner and Sharla, 2015. So this looked at welfare spending and fertility for 23 OECD countries from 1980 to 2007. So in that time period, there was an increase in spending on the welfare state of 21.5%, and there was a 2.1% across the board increase in fertility. So this is a very broad brush measure, but it kind of dovetails with the other data that we've seen, which shows that there's a rise in kids born in response to incentives in the welfare state. Now, what do we do? Well, you probably see a lot of arguments in the press, in the media, about benefit caps and things like this. Should it be 26,000 or 25,000? You know, people arguing about absolute values. Well, instead of doing that, what I would suggest is a much more basic approach. Just adjusting policy so that these three columns become equal. Because then we'll know that the welfare state isn't causing extra kids to be born into disadvantaged households, you know. And so therefore it would no longer be a mechanism for personality damage. There's a separate moral question of whether the welfare state should be causing any children to be born into disadvantaged households, but that's something that you kind of would have to ask answer from a philosophical point of view. This is more just, at least this would mean that there's no more kids than the other categories being born into these troubled households on average, and therefore won't have the risk of personality damage. So, having said all that, this is only one scenario, so this may be totally out of step with evidence that other people have gathered. I don't know. It's possible. So, we're just seeing one possible future, and I would suggest that we need to check out whether this really is plausible, and I hope somebody much cleverer than me will have a go at it at some point. One criticism I've already had is that this book presents a solution to a problem that doesn't exist, because some people think there is no link between the welfare state and work motivation, which, fair enough, you know, that's one argument. Other people would say there is a link, but it's only temporary, okay? And I will concede that at a point, partly, because there's good evidence. Nickel, 97, investigated the effects of benefits on unemployment rates in 20 OECD countries and found that high unemployment was associated with generous benefits, as well as the existence of regulations that allow sort of unlimited periods of claiming. James Bartholomew has shown that unemployment rates are usually lower in nations such as Switzerland, which rigorously enforce the requirement for claimants to seek work. So, that's the link. But that's a temporary link. It would suggest that if you make it tougher for people to avoid work, then unemployment goes down. We see this in nations like Germany. So, this is German unemployment, and this arrow here is when the Hartz reforms were put in place. These were a series of far-reaching reforms to the German welfare state, which made it much stricter about whether people could turn down a job. So instead of previously where you could sort of turn down a job if you didn't fancy it, the Hartz reforms, in essence, meant you had to take whatever work was available. And you can see here there was a sort of trickle-down effect, and when you just say, well, that's an age effect, you know, there's some kind of just as people get older, they get less, have less bravado, you know, less likely to say they'll claim unfortunately. But what he did then is he looked at different birth cohorts when they're surveyed at the same age. So we can see here, this is born before 1936, and reluctant to cheat the system, even when they're surveyed at the same age as this younger cohort, which in turn was less willing to cheat compared to this younger cohort. The most willing to cheat of all were the people born after 1970. So he partly addressed these problems of age effects. But this is just self-report. This is not actual, these are not actual claims. These are just what people say they do. So what people say they do, what they do may be very different. So if you look here, this is Martin Jung's work on sick benefit claims. This is actual claims. And he finds a similar thing. So the younger the cohort, the more sick benefit they use, even when surveyed at the same age as the older cohorts. And the key thing about the Swedish sick benefit system is it's self-certifying. So for the first week, you just decide yourself whether you're ill. So Martin Jung calls it a sort of giant marshmallow test. And they found, like, for example, there's more sick benefit claims when there's a major sporting event on television, things like that. So this is actual benefit claiming behavior, and you can see it quite closely follows the self-reported results in that way. And the really crazy thing is the younger generations had much better health. So if they were being honest, they should have claimed less sick benefit than the older generations who smoke more, drank more, and have generally worse health. So these data are consistent with the notion that the welfare state is gradually proliferating employment-resistant personality characteristics from generation to generation. This is something that's well known. There's eminent researchers such as the Swedish economist Assar Lindbeck, who wrote that the supply of benefits creates its own demand. Indeed, moral hazard and cheating are, in my judgment, the weak spot of the welfare state. This was in 1995. This was before these studies had been done. So he was kind of predicting these studies. But then James Heckman, more explicitly, said participation in generous welfare states leads to erosion of the work ethic and withdrawal from participation in the social compact. There's evidence of cohort drift in welfare participation. These cohorts who have lived a greater fraction of their lives under the generosity of the welfare state come to accept its benefits and game the system at higher rates. So if individuals such as these guys who are Nobel laureates appear to think there's a problem, then it could be the case that there is. But the point is, the mechanism for this proliferation of gaming the system, withdrawing from social compact, the mechanism has not been shown. And that's the point in the book, is this argument is just one possibility. There could be others, and it would be great if other people now chip in with sort of counter theories proposing the reason why the welfare state erodes work motivation. And if you have counter evidence, please bring it forward. That's all I can say. Thank you.
Time once they can get signed onto disability. Did that?
I haven't actually seen that data, but that would fit then with what Martin Young showed, with the sick benefits and freezing. And the key irony is that the younger generations are much healthier in all these indices.
Right, and you'd expect younger Americans to be healthier because it's less like manual labour or whatever.
They don't smoke too much, it's things like that on average. And so he was surprised when he found these data.
I'll dig some stuff out for you on that and email you.
Yeah, well, thanks very much. Okay, well, time to go to the pub then. Oh, sorry, there's one there. The actual behaviour, and I'm not sure if he interviewed his participants, because in Sweden there's a clever system where each person has a unique ID number, so they can be tracked remotely through their whole lives from birth to death, and all their criminality or their use of a particular government institution is logged automatically. So I don't think he did, but it would be a great follow-up study.
Another question, which is, I've read the book, I'm sorry, but do you get to a conclusion that sort of, you refer to it as work resistant, but laziness, does that creep into it? Creep into the personality?
Conscientiousness and agreeableness are correlated, but they do capture different facets of behaviour. So the best way to think about it, I think, is just lack of socialisation. So whatever you're socialised to do, if you do it less, either in a sort of cooperative sense, then you score low on agreeableness. And if you do it less in a sort of reliability sense, that notion that you should turn up at work every day, that kind of thing. But in other cultures, socialization may take a very different route. Like historically, in Inuit cultures, they practice senicide, which is the killing of the older generation to save food. And so you can foresee that a person who's not well socialized in that context would refuse to go along with murdering old people, which to us would seem like being a good thing. But in that historical context, if you had one person who couldn't hunt and make their contribution to the tribe, the whole tribe could starve to death. So it's a very interesting thing. And what we talk about as agreeableness and conscientiousness may have slightly different meanings in other groups, possibly. Anyway, thanks. There's copies of the book available at a huge discount, by the way.
Two questions, actually.
Hello, sorry. Just a quick question about the employment-resistant personality disorder. So does employment change the degree of conscientiousness that...
Yes, it improves it. There's evidence that German research by Alex Wood and his colleagues, that in Germany there's a system for tracking cohorts, and there's a personality measure in that. And they found some evidence that unemployment reduces conscientiousness and agreeableness, so being disillusioned. But it was a very complex pattern. There was no straight effects that were significant, but there were some interactions with gender. So it's a good question, and I think it's going to be a growing research field.
And just to follow that up, they looked at, in the German panel data, conscientiousness in children, and followed those kids up in later life. And those lower conscientiousness were more likely to be unemployed.
About $16 return for every $1 spent by the age of 40. So it's well worth doing. So at the end of the book, I just say, well, we know that childhood disadvantage damages personality, but intensive preschool tutoring can partly ameliorate that. We know that there seems to be a problem with policy influencing fertility. So what I say is, why don't we just work on both? Now, then you can, the kids who are already born and who are born into troubled households can be helped, their outcomes won't reach the average. They'll still be significantly less successful in their life outcomes than average, but at least they'll be significantly more successful than they haven't been receiving this tutoring. I would say they're both.
Other question?
Mental health difficulties fit in with the whole picture, you know, because we know that there's a much higher likelihood of people having mental health issues within disadvantaged environments or households.
Well, personality is at present divided into five dimensions. That doesn't mean there aren't other dimensions, doesn't mean that other models are wrong, but the current sort of consensus is five dimensions, which includes neuroticism, which is. The higher you score on neuroticism, the more at risk you are for a mental health problem. So it's another question is whether being raised in a disadvantaged household increases neuroticism scores, which is highly likely, I would say. Having a, imagine coming home and there's a chaotic thing going on in your house and you've got no place of refuge. That would make me stressed, you know. So, but it's something I haven't looked at and I think someone should.
Any more questions? Yep, we have one here.
So I actually wanted to comment a little bit on your initial question coming from the States and kind of build on what we've been talking about. But welfare in the States is very much under the same vein as disability services in the States, in that there is constantly someone there trying to make sure that you are looking for work. But at the same time, their services in the best way, and no disrespect to the UK, is most parallel to the HMRC. So it's basically, the best way I can say it is it's a lot of people, but they're very inefficient. So the best example I can give is that my mom, she does sonography, so ultrasound. She had a patient fall on her and she dislocated her shoulder. So she was forced to be on disability. But because our healthcare system is not universal, she had to get surgery for her shoulder, pay for it out of pocket, because insurance wasn't going to cover it, but at the same time was not able to go back to work because she was not allowed to until the surgery happened. So she's not getting paid. She needs to go back to work in order to get paid to get the surgery that will let her go back to work. So with that being said, I think there's a lot of issues with the States and how they operate. Like I said, disability and welfare are in the same vein. There might be someone there constantly patrolling and making sure you're looking for work, but not really doing anything to help you get there. So, yeah.
I think that's the difference. If you read James, I've got James Bartholomew's book here. He looks in detail at the different welfare systems across the globe. And for example, the Hartz reforms weren't just a sort of big stick. They also had a carrot to help people properly to get back to work. And in Switzerland, I understand the system is even more sort of strong in that you get a lot of help to get back to work, but they are strict, so there's not much wiggle room.